meeting back to order. Town Administrator. In accordance with the open meeting law, the board states for the record that this meeting is being recorded by NORCAM and may be recorded by other local media. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome our guests this evening and those watching on cable. A little echo. The first item on our agenda are the minutes. And I'm going to again recommend that we pass over the March 28th and September 19th executive session because we were supposed to have a discussion in executive session. We did not do that. November 21st, 2016, regular session. Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the November 21st, 2016, regular session minutes as written.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? We also have an executive session for the 21st.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the November 21st, 2016 executive session minutes as written.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? We have the November 21st insurance meeting, which took place in the afternoon before our regular meeting.
Mr. Chairman, for the record, that's a regular session of the Board
yes.
of Selectmen.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the November 21st, 2016 insurance meeting minutes as written.
I will second that, but I will be abstaining.
This was a meeting with the, oh, okay. This was a meeting with the Insurance
How
Advisory
about if I second
Committee.
That? I'll
and
second.
I had the okay. meeting posted just in case there were more than two board members present. And I believe there was.
And Steve,
I
will second that. They said.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Abstain.
Opposed?
I
Abstention?
To abstain.
Did you capture that?
I did.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. We need to vote to approve the 2017 regular meeting schedule.
Mr. Chairman, through you. Just briefly for the board and for the public as well. The board's meeting schedule is traditionally the first and third Monday of the month. In this particular upcoming month of January, both of those days are legal holidays. The reason we've been advised to ask the board to vote to schedule the regular meeting schedule is because at one of those January meetings, the board will be required to set the 2017 town meeting schedule. And so town's bylaw requires that schedule will be set at a regular meeting. So this just clarifies for the record that although the meetings are taking place on Tuesdays, those meetings will be considered regular meetings of the Board of Selectmen.
I have a motion. Ms. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to set the dates of the regular meetings for January 2017 as follows. Tuesday, January 3rd, 2017, and Tuesday, January 17th, 2017.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Questions, Mr. Yule?
Yeah, I'm just looking at that, and I was just trying to understand. Are we going to be doing this for every month now?
No. This is because in January, under the town bylaws, we have to vote the town meeting dates.
Right.
And it says that we have to do it on a Monday.
Right.
So we've been advised that we should post secure these January Monday meeting dates because we can't have them on Mondays. They're both holidays.
Oh, so then every time we don't have a meeting on a Monday, second, first, and
no,
third, we have
no,
to do this?
No, just it's related to the fact that in January at a regular meeting,
right.
which is normally on the first or third Monday
right.
of the month, we are obliged
right.
to vote on the town meeting dates.
Oh, okay.
the town meeting dates are normally set, except that if there's a holiday or religious holiday, we have to vote a different date.
This just allows us not to have a special meeting on a Monday in order to conform with the bylaws.
Okay, thank you.
Because of the holidays.
On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We have a joint appointment with the Hillview Commission, and I believe that, I don't.
We've got five of the six remaining.
Five of the six.
Five of the six. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. O'Leary.
Mr. Chairman, this is.
Why don't you start it off?
Yeah, this joint meeting between the Hillview Commission and the Board of Selectmen is a direct result of the resignation of Jack Collins midterm in his term as a member of the commission. Jack served close to 20 years as a member of the commission and did yeoman's work along with all the other members of the commission here. They quietly go about their business and run our enterprise and run it as a business and have been very successful, and the fruits of their labor are quite evident throughout the community. And, you know, to Jack, we certainly thank him very much for his services. And last Wednesday evening, I met with the commission to go over the applicants for filling this unexpired term, and it was the unanimous recommendation of the Hillview Commission and myself as liaison to recommend William King. And again, that's not to diminish the value and willingness of people, other people who step forward to serve. But before we get any further, I'd like to defer to the chairman of the Hillview Commission, one of the original members of the commission, the longest serving member of the commission, Chairman George Stack, just for a few words. Yep.
Mr. Stack.
I know you're not a sitter, yeah. We're lucky he's not circling the table here.
Pardon me. Is it on?
It is.
Am I going? Yeah, Jack was on the commission 20-some-odd plus years. He was our negotiator, which is important in the appointment we're making. He was the fellow that would especially deal with the golf cart companies. And once the contract was given, he found a way to get all these extras that made for better customer relations at the Hillview, and a lot of times kept golf clubs dry. He also was part of the team to negotiate with the management contracts and with the contract for the lease agreements we always had. So he's a big loss. Personally, it's a pleasure for me to stand here because the last two appointments we had were not through happy circumstances. We had lost two members. This time, Jack decided to retire, he and his wife. They're living in New Hampshire and Florida. He sends his best. He said he would be down here Wednesday night, but he never did make it, and I think that's probably never going to happen again. So with that in mind, he was great. He really worked well. He was very involved, extremely involved, and he'll really be missed the time he gave. The other one I'd like to thank was Bob Torres. I called Bob Thursday because I heard he had retired. I was retiring, and I said, the last time I spoke to you about retirement, you told me it would be a year. And he says, well, it's a year. And I said, I can't believe it's a year. But Bob was just a good guy. What he wrote was everything he heard, and he always wrote the truth. There was never any other side but what was presented to be in the newspaper. He was a great supporter of the Hillview. Anytime over the 30 years we wanted publicity, he'd be there. He'd take pictures. Anything we sent would be put into the newspaper. And he covered us when it was the old town hall, which is the library now, way up on the top of the elves, up in the building, and we'd trudge up every night for close to almost a year to determine whether or not the count could really afford to take the Hillview. And he was there. He wasn't the editor. He was the reporter, and everything he put in there, the townspeople got, and they could make their own balanced decision on whether or not when they came to town meeting, if they would vote to support us or not support us. So on behalf of the commission and behalf of the town through the Hillview, I'd like to thank Bob for all his years. And I'm assuming you're the new guy with the yellow pad there. So welcome. And you'll be hearing from me. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, George.
George, thank you.
Do you have any other comments before I ask for a motion? Mrs. Menapelli, would you read the motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following names for appointment to the Hillview Commission to fill an unexpired term through December 31st, 2019.
Okay.
One, Vincent J. Rigucci III, 167 North Street, file. Two, William A. King, 8 Little Meadow Way, file. Three, Peter Antonuccio, 61 Haverhill Street, new. Four, Rick Arrington, 8 Tacoma Circle, file. Five, Sean T. Delaney, 7 Dick Street, file.
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. We will start with the Hillview Commission. Mr. Hashi?
Is absent.
He's absent.
Should come to the speak, to the microphone.
Just keep in mind, there's one position and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 applicants. So we're doing a roll call vote. Mr. Hemme.
William King.
Catherine, are you keeping tally?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Doherty.
William King.
Is this right? Is Mr. DeFranzo?
Mr. DeFranzo, yeah. DeFranzo.
Mr. DeFranzo.
William King.
Mr. Carucci.
William King.
Mr. Stack.
William King.
Okay, now for the board. Mrs. Menapelli.
William King.
Mr. Yule.
William King.
Mr. Prisco.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. O'Leary.
Mr. King.
Mr. Masseri, that's me. Mr. Delaney. And based on the votes, I think it's safe to say that Mr. King is now a member of the Hillview Commission.
It just as an update, Mr. Chairman, if you'd like to, Mr. Chairman Stack, if you'd just like to give an update as far as, you know, the kitchen, the pub, and how that's going. And
I would, but I'd like to get how that was written, please. The date? The date that expires.
Oh, December 31st, 2019.
To fill the position.
Yes, and it's for the remaining of Jack's term.
Which would be the end of 2017.
Yes, 17. I don't think it's 19. I think it's an unexpired term.
And what did the motion say? Why don't we correct that? Where did the 19 come from?
It's just a three-year term. Normally it's a three-year term.
Mr. Chairman, it's carried as a three-year term. But this is a mid-year appointment, and thus the joint vote.
So that should, the motion should read through December 31st, 2017?
2017. That's a Scrivener's error, right, Mrs. Menapelli?
I just corrected it on both forms, unless you think we need to.
It's good.
That's
I think everybody understood we were filling the term. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll sit down to fill you in on the kitchen.
Okay. Right. Just the kitchen.
Oh, God. Is it that bad?
Because yeah. I can't stand up when I speak to the kitchen. It's too painful.
So you're just giving us a report.
Just an update.
It's
okay.
Finished.
Thank you, George.
It's finished. Mr. Yeva has been running some functions down in the bottom of the basement. I should say the bottom of the basement. But in the pub area, you know, bereavements, maybe showers and things like that. So the kitchen is all set to go. When it's going to be open, that's his call. I suspect perhaps March, before the golf season starts. He's going to be running a full tavern, pub-type food, and it should go well.
What are the planned hours, George? Do you know?
We don't know yet. No.
Well, wasn't there something in the agreement?
No, it's entirely up to Mr. Yeber as to what he did, other than he was required to have normal business hours for the golf season,
yes,
which basically
he will.
April through October, November, at a minimum.
He will.
And he has agreed to that, so it'll be just normal business hours for the golf season.
You did a great job over there, you know. We could even have a guided tours, you know, maybe we can make money that way, you know.
Yeah.
But he did a great job, and I'm sure he's going to do a real good job and get a good following in the town. And I think his price point, he said, would be very comparable, and he thinks people will be very happy with it. So.
And again, I'd like to acknowledge the effort on the part of the commission, Dan, Chuck, George, Peter, actually the entire commission, in relation to getting this project done. It took on a life of its own, which the town administrator can vouch for. And fortunately, now it's completed. And we look forward to a very successful undertaking here at the pub. And I think when people go down there, they're going to see a substantial change to the interior and the venue. It's going to be terrific. So we wish Mr. Yeber a lot of success. And again, I'd like to acknowledge the extraordinary effort that was put into getting this project undertaken and completed. There was a lot of heartburn involved. It wasn't had anything to do with the food.
Right. So. I think you and I know through our history on the commission that we tried to get that kitchen fixed unsuccessfully many times.
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Frisco.
So we were there a few, probably 6 weeks ago, and I did tour the kitchen. What a beautiful job. It really is. It's A1. So you guys should be very proud of the design, and the equipment is fantastic. Is there a plan for them to serve breakfast in the summer? Is that at all in the plans? Have you even had any mumblings or grumblings about it?
Well, we're mumblings.
Yeah.
I'm not sure where that's going. We don't know. We really don't know what he has in mind. He's an entity unto himself. And, you know, we might find a sign all of a sudden one day saying breakfast. but he will open gradually, and then once he's into it, he'll have a full staff, you know, a full-time chef there. And, you know, and it'll take off.
I understand business. If it just doesn't make sense for him to do it financially, I respect that.
Yeah.
But if the feedback could get back that I have heard from others in the community, it would be nice to go to Hillview and have breakfast again.
Yeah.
And if it's affordable and they can make it work.
If Mr. Yeber can make money, he will have it.
Yeah.
I right. Respect that. And that's the way it should be.
He's already had a couple of functions. I didn't even know about. He had a comedy night that was very successful. And he has this big Christmas party that I have no idea. It's just happening. What
and that's what you want.
It's just happening.
And he's a wonderful addition to the community, and we're very thankful he's there.
He will be.
He did a nice job at the ballroom as well. Thank you.
Thank you, George.
Thank you.
Okay, moving
thank you,
right,
gentlemen.
Moving right along,
appreciate it.
The vote to approve the town school agreement. Liz, you want to make comments or fill us in on that? Both you and Michael, or?
Right on time, too. Ooh. Pretty good.
Thank you. So this evening, we're hoping to get your approval and support of updates we have made to the town school agreement. And essentially what this is we are required by law to submit what is known as the end of the year financial report to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education on an annual basis. And what that report is it essentially is sort of a source and use report that reports all expenditures and revenue expended on an annual basis, fiscal year basis by the school department. It also includes costs that was incurred by the town that can be associated and contributed to the schools as well. And all schools and towns are required to have a written methodology, both approved by the Board of Selectmen and the school committee, that essentially essentially walks you through how those costs that are contributed to the town but are school related will get charged onto the report. So it's essentially a housekeeping item. We had the report is also required to be audited on an annual basis. This last auditing cycle, it was suggested and recommended that both myself and Ms. Rourke review the report, because I believe that had been since 2010, since it had last been reviewed in detail. So we had done that. We made some, I would say, characterize them as some very minor changes, and updates that should not impact in any substantial way the way we are reporting the results and the costs on the report. So I think that is kind of encompasses what we're looking to do here this evening. I don't know if there's any questions or anything further.
Michael?
When's the report going to be available?
So the end of the year financial report is essentially, it's due to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education by September 30th of every year. So this report for expenditures incurred last fiscal year 2016, has been completed and submitted. So the changes that we're making now would be for next fiscal year, and for the report that we'd be, for the cost we'd be filing for September 30th, 2017.
This is aimed to get a more accurate and more uniform across the state cost per pupil?
What the state does is they take this data and they, it does generate and take out our cost per pupil expenditure amount that they report out annually. It does feed into our foundation budget, which does impact the amount of Chapter 70 that we receive. So it is very important that we make a concerted effort to get the report as accurate and as consistent as we can throughout the fiscal year. And I think certainly myself and Ms. Rourke worked very closely every August and September to make sure that that happens.
So, Mr. Chairman, so last budget season I had made a request that our fixed cost should be broken out to the next level. I don't know if you recall me making that request, because I just think it's important that we, even though we do take it off the top, and I'm not saying we should change that process, but we should have an understanding of those fixed costs, what are really related to the school side and what's the town government side. So we have just an idea. I'm not saying we have to actually break it down any more than that, but I think it's helpful for the community to see that, and I think it's helpful for you to have that argument with the state. And it may help us with our formula to help assist us in those funds. So I'm not sure if you had that planned in the budget, that we're going to see that this year. Ms. O'Rourke, I'm not sure if you had that.
We can do that.
We've, in the interest of transparency, we've put a lot of lines on the revenue and expense forecast, so we'll have to see how we how we break up the allocation. It's bursting at the limit of two pages. I'm sure we could find a way.
We got this big screen now, Mike. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And Liz, I'm sorry, go ahead. Yes, Catherine.
I was just wondering, is this, Liz, do you compile this information?
Yes.
Okay.
Because you handle all the fixed costs out of this building, correct?
Correct. Okay. And I compile all of this information that's in front of you for the school department.
So my question, Liz, was related to how much effort on your part.
To compile the information?
Yes.
I think it's probably about a month. There's several departments that are involved that I have to request the information from them as well. Mm-hmm. Some of the information I have readily available, especially on the benefits costs and capital items and whatnot. So it's a joint effort between the school and town and finance department.
Any other questions?
No, other than this is just more or less routine.
And bringing it up to date,
right.
To actually how we report, because there were some of the things in here that we weren't actually reporting exactly that way. So this brings it to what we need to report on and what we actually are reporting on.
Again, this is aimed at capturing the exact cost of running the school department.
The town's share of cost.
Yes, the town's share. The report does break out pretty clearly what's school and what's on the, the town side that I can contribute to the school department expenses.
Mr. Okay. Chairman, just one more comment.
Yes, Michael.
And I hope, Mr. Conley, you're going to continue to do the unfunded liabilities report that you've done in the last few years. I find that to be extremely eye-opening. I never realized the magnitude of expense the school incurs on those unfunded requirements. Mm-hmm. And I think the last number, if I recall from last year, was approaching $10 million.
That's correct.
That sound about right?
Yeah.
It's amazing, and I think that has to be studied when we look into everything else as well.
Yep.
Thank you for doing that. I know it's a lot of work on your part. But I appreciate it. It certainly has helped me understand the budget a little bit better.
We need to give them as a stipend.
Okay. We have a motion to vote to approve the town school agreement.
Mr. Chairman, I move to authorize the chairman to sign the agreement between the school department and the town's finance division on reporting of town expenditures not recorded within the school appropriation.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule.
And I'm serious about that. It's a lot of work.
I think there's no more discussion. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Liz.
Thanks, Mike, for coming in.
We have a public hearing scheduled in 5 minutes. I suggest we just take a break for 5 minutes. There's cookies here for anyone that would like. To order. And we have a show cause hearing for Pendleton Ventures Inc., DBA, Tedeschi Food Shops. Are there members of
Mr. Chairman, would you like to read the notice?
Read the notice.
There isn't a notice.
Oh, okay.
Just got a copy of the notice.
I'm mistaken, Mr. Chairman. There's no notice of public hearing. We did issue a letter in accordance with the board's vote at the meeting of December 15th. Mm-hmm. The letter dated December 5th, excuse me.
Do you have a copy of it?
Yep, it's in the packet, dated December 6th. We could read that letter if the board were so inclined.
No, I'm looking for it. It's not right after the...
I'm not seeing it here. I thought I saw it earlier.
Right here.
Yeah. Thanks, though, Chris.
All right. It's already from yours. Okay, this is a certified letter that went to Pendleton Ventures, Inc., 28 Cox Street, Hudson, Mass. Dear Mr. Pendleton, on Monday, December 19, 2016, at 8:15 p.m., the Board of Selectmen will hold a hearing on the matter of your package store wine and malt beverage license. Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 138, Section 16A, govern liquor license renewals, which are deemed automatic as long as the renewal is for the same type as the expiring license and covers the same license premises. In addition, Chapter 138, Section 15 requires the license to describe the licensed premises. It is our understanding that you no longer have legal rights or access to the licensed premises. You may attend this hearing and provide any information regarding access to the property, absent which the Boards of Selectmen may be required to deny the renewal. It was signed by Michael Gilberto, Town Administrator.
Mr. Pendleton's right there.
Mr. Pendleton.
Whichever.
Sure.
You can sit at a microphone or you can stand at the...
I know. Evening. A couple of notes. I hope that you grudge me the time to go through a couple issues. At the current time, I do not clearly have access to the facility. As you know, we applied for a new license transfer at the facility, which the board subsequently denied. As part of that purchase and sales, I entered into with the original buyer. He was given a certain amount of time to hold the license or reapply. He then reapplied at Richdale, which the board subsequently denied. I'd like to note that although the statute in the notice requires the same type, the ABCC does allow latitude to approve a license and carry it in without a location. It's even now in the application form which the town sent me. There's a box that says, please provide if you do not have access to location, with a description, with a letter which was provided with my application to the ABCC. Along with that, there is precedent for a grace period under ABCC rulings and state appellate court rulings if the license is subsequently denied and then appealed. So I would ask the board to renew it as is without a location instead of going through the appeal process and allow some time. I have been working on a couple different scenarios. The new owners, there's a new tenant at 202 North Street and they've expressed interest as well. I've had another buyer approach me, and there's one deal I'd like to work out on my own, potentially. In the hearings from the ABCC, it says that the law is clear that a licensee cannot cease operation, sit silent, and avoid contact with the local board without facing real peril of cancellation of his license. I would say I've met every one of those criteria. I've not sat idle. I had a deal in place to sell the license 3 months before the property actually closed. The application was submitted, I think, within a week of the actual closing. I've never avoided contact with the board. I was at the hearing. At that hearing, I requested to the board what I needed to do to move forward with the board and how much time I would have, not at the board's behest. The board said 60 days. I came back to the board with the applicant, came back to the board within 60 days to meet that requirement. Following the hearing on November 21st, the board, I'm not sure how long the board took to issue their decision to the applicant, to the applicant. And then he had 5 days to then, 5 business days, wrapped around a holiday, which is Thanksgiving, to appeal to the ABCC, which apparently he's foregone because I'm here right now. In that span, there's been very little time to do any actual business. I think it's really only been maybe 2 weeks. And I received this hearing on the 7th, so maybe less than that, to get anything really substantial done. I couldn't exactly talk to the one buyer who contacted me multiple times in good faith and start working on a deal when I didn't know the status of the license. That's just not the right way to do business in my mind. The other issue I would have with the hearing in general is the board or the town, I'm sorry, I'm not sure how the license applicants are submitted, the applicants are submitted, did process my check for the application, which is a fee for the license and not a fee for the application. So it's, as far as I understand from Mass General Law, that's implied acceptance of the application. So I would just ask the board, I know it's at their full discretion to do what they choose to vote because I do not have current access. We haven't had much discussion with the current tenants of whether we can work something out. But I am working with it. We're not sitting idly on the license, trying to work something out. I've invested a good amount of my savings into the license initially, and our goal is to recoup that and to maybe move forward with the business. The board has said before that it's business friendly, and I'd like to pursue that again, possibly myself, if it works out. Obviously, there's lease issues and stuff like that are difficult to work out sometimes. As well as a lot of my funds have been tied up with the closing of my business. My franchisor has a extended amount of time to hold my money for any bills to be paid, electricity, all those, any debtors to seek their funds. So I won't receive that money probably until the beginning of the year. So it's hard to pursue a business until I have those funds available. I think that's all I have to say unless the board has questions.
Mr. Yule?
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Had Tedeschi's not sold the business to, 7-Eleven, would you have continued your business?
Yes. If they'd have sold to any other convenience store chain, I would have been able to continue my business. But because it was 7-Eleven in the close proximity, they chose their existing tenured franchisor over a franchisee over my location, which was there right under the contract.
Right. So you were left standing without a business, and
correct,
consequently here you are, which has nothing to do with us, but I think it should be appreciated that this was not of your doing.
Correct. I didn't let a lease lapse or not sign. I just
right.
had no choice in the matter.
And you've already, as you stated, you submitted the payment for the renewal of the.
I submitted a full application, noting that there was no location available.
And it was accepted by the town.
And it was accepted and processed on the.
Check was deposited.
23rd of the of November.
At this point, I think that's it for me.
Can you confirm that, Michael?
I just checked with the licensing agent, Jane, and that's correct. It's something we would do as a matter of practice with any check that comes in rather than have a check lie around in the office unsecured. It's deposited.
Is that refundable to him?
I certainly don't see any reason why we could not refund it if the board opted to not renew the license.
But that's not an application fee. That's a license fee? Or was that the application renewal fee?
No, I state it as the license fee. I mean, the license has that fee listed on it. As far as I know, that's...
The annual application fee, right? There, or is there a separate license fee, too?
The application fee and the license fee are the same amount.
The same. Same amount or the same?
Same amount.
When he sent the notice, it's called the license application renewal. And it says how much it costs. And then he sends that application renewal form back and with the check.
which covers the license for the next year.
So we would have to refund that.
Sure.
Be back.
Yeah, I mean, it's a.
Prove it, yeah.
But that's not his point.
No, his point was that the town accepted the license.
My hope is that they continue to accept it and allow me to pursue another, a grace period to pursue business. And I'll come back at any time if it's 3 months to update the town. Obviously, I'm not going to spend money in perpetuity, just giving the town $2,500 every year to hold the license for nothing. That wouldn't do me any good as a businessman. It wouldn't do my family any good. I just asked for the grace period that the ABCC has, in multiple decisions, granted other licensees to try to figure out a solution.
How much time are you asking for?
Generally, if I can read the hearing, an ABC subsequent decision in restaurant Streg Air, it is established a general understanding in the industry that the licensee can prove that it has been attempted to transfer its license and not merely sitting on its hands while the licensee is not being used, that the local license authorities will allow it 6 months from the date it receives notice of potential cancellation to actually transfer its license before the license is canceled. I don't want to pursue this forever. I mean, if I can get this, if it's renewed and there's not an applicant, or, you know, other than potential lease delays of trying to get a lease in, but the board will be updated of that. I'm not going to pursue it forever. 6 months, if it's not 6 months, I'll hand the license to the board at a public hearing. Put that in writing if you'd like. If there's nothing to be pursued, I'm not going to sit idly on it. If we can't get something done early, I'm not going to just spend money pursuing everything. There's lawyer's fees, there's time and effort. I run two other businesses. I got two very active kids. I don't have all day to pursue it, but I don't want to lose my investment.
When did your lease expire? On
August
1st?
Technically, from I had to be out July 28th. So the building could be sold on August, closed on August 1st, so they had to clear out empty equipment, but I had till August 28th. I'm sorry, July 28th.
Can I ask a question, Mr.
Yes.
Chairman? Are you trying to open a new business in North Reading right now?
I have one pursuit of my own that I would like to pursue a new business, yes.
Is similar to what you had before?
No, a different concept.
Not a convenience?
Not a convenience.
And retail?
No.
Okay. And you also mentioned you had a couple of other parties that
Yes, I mean, the current residents at 202 North Street expressed interest, and I have one. I don't know what the other party is. They've called me 3 or 4 times, expressing interest in the license. I don't know what their plans would be, a location. I haven't discussed them. I told them I wouldn't discuss anything further until following this meeting. If there wasn't, I couldn't operate in good faith and give them information.
So your business that you're trying to pursue in North Reading, it wouldn't have a liquor license attended to it?
Oh, no, beer and wine only. I mean, that's obviously to move my beer and wine license to a new business venture. That's my goal.
Mr. Chairman, when was the initial application for transfer submitted to us? Do you recall?
I don't have it at the top of my head. I know it was the initial we heard in August.
That's correct.
Oh, that's right, August 22nd. I wasn't
yes.
here.
That's yeah,
correct.
That was the second yes. hearing, correct?
Yeah.
That's correct.
That was the first one. The first one you weren't
that
here.
That was the meeting I wasn't here.
Second one you were here for.
So the first one was in July.
It was
July.
August.
August
1st. August.
It was the first of the beginning
yeah.
of August. It was
records.
Very quickly after
Actually,
the
it was
we
July
can,
because
we
continued it
records.
To August.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't at the very first hearing. I could not be. We were
it was July because it was at the first meeting. It was continued until August 22nd or whatever
That's
it was,
right.
and I was away.
We got clarifications. You're
so,
right.
So
yeah.
it was July.
It was August 1st and August 22nd. Those
yeah.
were the two hearing dates.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
He left close out on. He left on a Thursday. It sounds like.
Yes, I had to leave. I had to leave on Thursday so the weekend to clean.
It was a weekend. We had a hearing on the 1st. It was continued to the 22nd.
So, but the same location can't reapply because it was already denied and it wasn't appealed. So
different I don't know how they handle, but it would be a different applicant.
Yeah, no.
It's not the same.
It's the same
business.
Location though.
I'm not sure how whether it's applicant, whether it's location or applicants. I've never dealt with that individual.
Mr. Chairman, the name.
Mr. Yule.
Thank you.
Tell Jane you're all set.
Wasn't the agreement, 7-Eleven bought out the Deskys, and they also bought, who bought the entire piece of property there?
7-Eleven sold, 7-Eleven bought the property from Tedeschi's as the purchase, and then they divested of the property in total to Stelio.
Right, and that's where the deed restriction comes in.
Yeah, that's, I'm not, I haven't seen it personally. I've
all been right, told the deed restriction, so, and that's for that property, right? Isn't that?
Yeah, right? Shall never be.
So nobody at that location can.
Well, they can't run a convenience.
Yeah, the marijuana is not excluded.
Right. Doesn't mean they can't.
Okay.
I'm excluded from marijuana. So
yes, that's why you would have a different business to allow you to have malt and liquor license and not be in conflict with the if you did it at that same location.
Right. I'm not sure. I'm not sure if that will work out. My particular venture would be at a different location if I was being able to sort of transfer to another location as well.
Mr. Smith.
So we're not here to review what we already denied.
Right.
This keeps coming up every time. We've already denied it, and that's the bottom line. It wasn't appealed. What he's talking about isn't at North Street. It's at a different location.
Right.
It's not even a convenience store. We don't even know what that is.
Mm-hmm.
So we can't be, this is a renewal situation only.
Mm-hmm.
And we've already denied it at North Street. This keeps reoccurring. We keep talking about the same petition at the same location that we've already voted to deny.
No, I'm not sure. He's asking us to give him an extension because he currently does not have a location to attach the license to.
Right. But it's not at North Street. He's
right.
Talking about... renew it, grant him the additional time that he's looking for to be able to work out some other arrangement.
Well, it's not necessary that, I guess we would have to renew it, right?
Yeah.
Because it runs out at the end of the year. So he's the current holder of the license, but he hasn't provided us evidence that he has a location.
Right.
To move
right.
the license to.
Right.
Or,
he's asking,
or another business that can come in and ask for the license like we did and we denied,
right?
Where he could sell that license to. I think that's your the intent, either to use it or to sell
yes.
it.
Yes, yeah. And there's precedent in the ABC and the appellate court. Board of Selectmen versus Saugus. Board of Selectmen of Saugus versus ABC. Ruled in the Massachusetts Appellate Court, if a licensee has proper notice and proper hearing, which this is proper hearing, clearly, it is established in Massachusetts that upon arrival of the notice of hearing, the license holder may be afforded a 6-month grace period to transfer or reactivate the license. I'm just asking for the grace period to see if we can find something in the town would find acceptable.
And that grace period would be effective when?
It's, according to the hearing, it says upon arrival of the notice of hearing. So I received
today. Okay.
Or the notice of the hearing was the 7th of December. I'm not sure exactly when I received it, 7th or 8th.
It was dated December 6th as a result of the board's vote on December 5th.
So I'm not sure when I received it versus via registered mail, but it was, say, December 6th.
We can track that date,
yeah.
But
yeah.
It would have been December.
So if the board chose to grant an extension, right, it wouldn't be that we would be granting a license. We would be basically putting something together that says,
you're granting the license for the grace period for 6 months for him to do what he can with it. It's an asset. It's currently an asset of his.
Yes.
It's a business
right.
asset.
Right.
And that business asset expires December 31st, 2016,
right.
Because he doesn't have a location at this particular point in time.
Right.
However, as he's pointing out, there may be some sort of case law and common practice through the ABCC, through appeals or whatever processes, which allows for a 6-month, for the licensing authority to grant a 6-month grace period in order for the current owner to
find another location or find another person who would like to locate the license somewhere else.
Right. So we have to we have to actually grant the license.
No.
Even if it's for
No. No. I'll be happy to get into a legal dialogue if that's what the board wants to do.
No.
This gentleman already asked the board for 60 days, and this board is working with him. So it doesn't start from a date of a notice.
Right.
This is the third time, actually the fourth hearing this has come up.
Right.
So we have given and extended and extended and extended the grace period. So if you're looking for a legal opinion based on what legal opinion was just represented to you, that's one thing. But if you're looking for a grace period and stuff, we've given the grace period. It's a decision, are you going to extend this license? It might be a business asset, but it's the only retail license we have left, and some other bona fide applicant might be coming forward with a place, you know, that wants to be considered. Instead, we're allowing someone to hang on to it indefinitely.
I didn't ask for anything.
We haven't made any decision, okay?
It sounds like you're thinking, because of what was just represented, that we have to renew a license.
No, not at all.
There's no location for this license.
Not at all. I was just trying to understand the process. Is it that we don't grant the license and we say, well, you're going to hold it for you for some period of time? And Steve corrected me on that. That's all.
No.
I was trying to understand what the process was.
But we've talked about this at each meeting. If we don't renew it now, it's gone. That's gone. It's no longer a business asset that he holds.
Right.
If he's got some sort of project in the works that the board wants to consider, it's not 6 months more time. We've already given him 60 days and then two different applications that weren't suitable. If there's something else that the board thinks they should renew this and make him come back in 60 days, then maybe that's one thing. But to just give six more months on this, you have to renew this, and then it's just lingering for six more months. That, to me, doesn't make much legal sense or practical sense either, in case there's another applicant out there that wants to come before the board. It's the last one of these that we have.
Mr. Chairman, I think, again, I was listening. I was thinking from a starting point. The lease was up. He left.
That's what I thought.
He's made a concerted effort to make a transfer. To me, the start date and the notification date by him to us would be the August 1st date. You know, if you go 6 months from there, you're talking the end of January. You know, if we're looking to consider any type of extension on the license, you know, extended to the end of January, which would cover a 6 month grace period from the time he was out of business, he's attempted to transfer it, find another location, whatever he's choosing to do. Little additional consideration for a longtime member of the business community, but at the same time, by the same token, not tying up the only license that's left for an extraordinary, what I would consider an extraordinary period of time. Does that make any sense logically?
Completely. To me, it does, yeah. I don't know if that's a realistic deadline for him, though.
But I don't know either,
yeah.
Other than I think that, you know, if we're going to give any type of consideration, Mr. Pendleton, then that's the type of consideration we should be considering. 6 months, I think, is an awful long time. And again, I would expect that he'd try and get it done post-haste, but by the same token, to your point, you're tying up the only license we have left for a potential bona fide applicant for an extended period of time. You might lose some opportunities there, too. So if you're talking fairness, as far as when the lease was up, when we were notified that he was vacated the premises, and then the 6 month period would take it beyond December 31st, but not necessarily beyond February 1st. Just throwing it out again, I'm not necessarily proposing it, I'm just thinking it through out loud.
So we would renew this. That's how we would move
you would
to
renew
it.
It.
Right.
Through
January.
Yeah,
so I have
January.
Another question then. If that was done, then he wouldn't be reimbursed the license fee.
Right, that's an opportunity that he's, and again, he may choose not to do that. Is it worth, is it, how much is it, $2,500? Is it worth $2,500 for a month? I don't know. That's a decision he has to make.
Of course, more than a month, because I won't have really access to funds till midway through January to sign a lease and put a deposit and do anything. I mean, month would be kind of tight. I mean, I'll be honest. I mean, the case history represents 6 months from the notice of hearing of cancellation. This is the hearing for cancellation. Every other hearing had nothing to do with cancellation of the license. I won't need the 6 months. I'm just saying
One point is I think we issued you a notice of cancellation just because of the circumstances. If we had not even done that, your license would have expired December 31st.
Right.
You know, we're doing this, I think, more as a courtesy to you to hear from you one more time as opposed to any other reason. We didn't have to do this necessarily. We didn't have to give you a notice of cancellation. You had to file an application. You filed the application. We could have just denied it outright, and then you would have, you know, gone to the ABCC, and you would have appealed it here, appealed it there, so on and so forth. This just, again, steps up the timeline in relation to the dialogue, as far as I'm concerned. You came before us in July or August telling us you didn't have a location anymore, and you're attempting to transfer it two times over. That's 5 months out of the calendar year.
I would note part of that 5 months, those two continuances from the board, so that it did eat up some time, and applicants' right to appeal in part of that time frame.
But the applicants decided not to appeal the decision of the board.
I would just say that ate up some of the time, if we, you know.
Absolutely, but that's all part of the risk of attempting to transfer it. Again, you attempted to transfer it, was denied. You can't appeal it. The applicant had to appeal it. They chose not to. So as far as the board, I think we've been pretty upfront and fair as far as hearing this thing, making a determination. Again, I personally wasn't here for the first one. But you notified us as of August 1st you didn't have a location. You know, so when it comes to renewal time, yes, you still were in that grace period. You applied. To me, you have, you know, another 30 days to get it done, if we even wanted to consider that. But
Jeff?
I think the question is, when's the start date of the cancellation? And you're saying it goes back to the
That's just a thought that I had. And again, I may not be, I'll defer to some other community's legal counsel.
I guess that's I need an answer to that question. When's the start date for the cancellation? Is it the August date, or is it the as of this meeting? And I think that he's talking about this meeting to be the start date for the 6 month period. So what would you,
Mr. Chairman?
Mike
says.
Yes, Michael.
Mr. Chairman, through you, so if I heard Mr. Pendleton correctly, he's referencing a decision of either the ABCC or a court that stated that,
each.
I'm sorry?
One of each.
That the local licensing authority may grant, and I emphasize may, not shall. And that is consistent with, from the conversations we've had with town council, that that 6 month rule is discretionary to the Board of Selectmen. And not instructive to the Board of Selectmen in that you have to. So, you know, we didn't delve that far into it when I had the discussion with Town Council. But my understanding is that that there's not a requirement that the board provide that window of time. So I just want to clarify that. If I going in terms of what the date is, if I understand what Mr. Pendleton read, he's referring to the notice that was sent to him dated December 6th. If I understood him correctly, I'm not saying he's right or wrong. That's just what I think he's saying.
Well, any other comments or thoughts? Michael?
I think we've given them plenty of time. You know, the situation came up. You knew you were selling your location. You've had plenty of time to find opportunities, which you tried. They didn't meet. I felt, at least didn't feel, met the need of the town, of the options that you brought here. It didn't work out. I say we take the license away at this point. We put it on the shelf. You still have the opportunity to go and find other business opportunities. And if the license is still here, you can apply for it. You can come in for the public hearing, and we could either grant it or not grant it. But I think continuing this is just a waste of everyone's time and certainly a waste of the applicant's time. I think we need to move on. I think we've given a lot of time on this. We've been talking about this since July. You've known about it since July. I know you've been working on it, but you haven't found the right opportunity that fits, you know, it's worked for you. And it certainly hasn't worked, at least for among yourself personally. So, you know, I've heard me say this before. It's not an entitlement. Sorry. If you go on, read the ABCC, read about it. You know, it's a public need. There's no public need there. There's no, at what you've brought forward so far. It just hasn't worked. So I'm ready to move on. I'm going to vote in favor of the motion as it's written.
Yes, the consensus from the board. Any other comments?
I'm somewhat inclined to grant some sort of an extension, whether it be 30 or 60 days. I'm not looking to go for 6 months. But again, I don't disagree with anything that's been said as far as the opportunities and considerations which have been given to the applicant over the last 5 months. But by the same token, I think it's there needs to be some sort of recognition of what we're allowed to do, what we can do, and longstanding business relationship that this gentleman's had in the community, an opportunity to transfer his business asset. Again, he has had 5 months to do it, but you know, to me, it's you know, if you tie it up for a month or two, so be it. And what he's risking is a $2,500 fee. But again, maybe we can prorate that too, if that's the case. But maybe it should be prorated. But if you just renew it for you know, through February 28th, not a leap year this year, that gives him 2 months or 2 weeks to continue and pursue whatever he's looking to do. He said, you know, from a financial standpoint, where he's severing his relationship with whoever it is, Tedeschi's, you know, it's not until January when things get settled up, he's financially able to find another location if that's what he's looking to do. And let's recognize that. I mean, he's been a good member of the business community. There haven't been any issues there. Been no complaints. So I would be inclined to offer some sort of a small window of additional opportunity for him. But again, he'd have to deem whether that's acceptable or not from the fee standpoint. And I'm not offering a motion yet.
You're not.
I'm throwing it out there for consideration.
Mr. Yule.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman. What I struggle with here is I see a family man who has a business, and corporate America has decided that they're going to merge, and he gets thrown out. And that's how I look at it. I know it's not our fault, and it's not our technically our issue, but I still look at that as someone who's trying to either salvage a business or start a new business or recover from the situation, the financial situation that he's been put in. You know, we had a situation here with Stop and Shop, where they took up roots, they moved to the north side of town, and then they restricted they were restricted from how they could use the property. I have problems with that whole concept, and I have problems with someone who's just trying to make a go of it and trying to make it doing whatever they can to keep either their business alive or to transfer a license to recoup some funds. So, you know, that's basically how I look at that. And yeah, in that case, I'm inclined. I don't care if we do this for 2 years, okay? Our situations may change as we progress, all right? If we have a buyer for this license, I might be holding a different viewpoint. I'm sorry.
Yeah, if he has
a buyer. No, not if he has one, but I mean, if there was somebody out there that was going to start a business and they wanted to use this license that's going to become available, you know, I might have a different thought or approach on that. But we don't have somebody else out there, and he's trying to find somebody he's looking to restart another business in town, which is good for the community. So, you know, I'm inclined to be as flexible as possible in helping someone within the business community reestablish a business and sell it to someone who's going to start a new business. So I'm receptive to that. And, you know, he has had 6 or 5 months, and maybe he needs 3 more. I don't know. I mean, I'm receptive to that. It doesn't tire me to go an extra yard for a business or for an individual. It doesn't tire me at all. Okay. The end result should be that we have an established business back in town creating tax revenue. And that, to me, should be our end goal. So I would be receptive to a motion that extended it 3 months. Yeah, 3 months. I mean, I don't have a problem with that.
Any other comments? I guess I look at it quite differently. First of all, the gentleman didn't pay for the license. And what he's asking us to do is to find a way of receiving some compensation for the license. And it's only that way because there are no other licenses to grant. And I know if you go into the city where the licenses are all used up, you know, same thing with a taxi with a license, right? They grow in value. But we could not grant this license, and we have it available, and we're not going to, you know, we have no way of charging the next business that comes along that we agreed to grant a license to charge them short of the license fee. So, I mean, I if he had paid for the license, right, in other words, bought the license from somebody, I might look at it a little differently and say, okay, maybe he deserves a little bit of an extension to try to recoup his loss. But in this case, there is no loss.
Could I correct that?
Mr. Pendleton has a comment.
I paid $40,000 to Paul Avigianos for the license. He's the former franchisee at Tedeschi Food Trucks.
You did?
I did.
That I didn't know.
6 years ago.
Meaning we were out of licenses back then?
No, meaning they just
they
had a business arrangement. They came in.
It's a business
the transfer
decision.
Was approved by the board, and off it went.
I don't believe there were any available at the time.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize that.
They're not available.
It's a business decision. That's all.
Like the goodwill, has a value. The inventory, the goodwill, the license. Right. Even though he doesn't own it, it's not a property right. It's part of the business acquisition valuation.
No, and again, we get requests from business owners all the time to allow them to put up the license as a business asset to a bank for lending purposes. So,
Michael, learn something? Yes, Michael.
Mr. Chairman, and I certainly don't want to prejudice the board with regards to whatever decision it's going to make, but I think I heard Mr. Pendleton indicate earlier that he was willing to stipulate that he would deliver the license back in some period of time if it were not transferred. If the board were to decide to extend some window of time to Mr. Pendleton, one way to perhaps streamline the business of the town and to ensure that the license is immediately made available and not otherwise tied up in an ABCC proceeding in the future would be to ask Mr. Pendleton to stipulate that he would not appeal the decision of the board to grant an extension for a period of time. And I offer that only because it would make the license more readily available and avoid a situation where Mr. Pendleton's appealing the board's decision, should it not decide to do that tonight. Board doesn't need to take that advice. I just offer that as something to consider to streamline the process if you were inclined to grant additional time. Thank you.
If there was a consensus, Mrs. Chairman, to move forward with granting an extension of time, it would have been my preference to include in that a stipulation that if the extension is granted, the applicant stipulates that at the time of that time period expires, there wouldn't be any appeal. There wouldn't be an appeal of this decision or at that point in time, any appeal. Otherwise, it's, you know, we're not looking to litigate or tie this thing up unnecessarily either.
Well,
the other point that I want to make is that obviously there's more incentive for this gentleman to go out there and beat the bushes to find someone to get this type of a license as opposed to waiting for it to happen.
Right.
You know, and again, we have had no other applicants this particular time for this license or this type of license beyond the number that we've had up to date. So we're looking to have someone beat the bushes and get another business going. Potentially there's your man. Michael has a Jim. Let's go.
Mr.
So based on that scenario, you're gonna make this gentleman go out, beat the bushes, find another opportunity, potentially.
I'm going to take his $2,500.
And then what? We vote against it, and then, I mean, then what? What did we just accomplish? The value is you don't waste anyone's time. You take it, they take the license back now. We put it on the shelf, and he can still go do that. And also the community can go out and look at opportunities. Maybe there's somebody who hasn't come to the table because there hasn't been any available, but now we have one available. It could spark some economic development. I don't know. But why do we want to pigeonhole ourselves at this point? There isn't a need. He doesn't have a business to transfer it to. We've given him ample opportunity. It's been 6 months. I'm not trying to be unreasonable. I'm a businessman too, but this isn't right. This is not right. I just think what we're doing here is absolutely 100% setting a bad precedent. And, you know, he has the opportunity to go and do what you're telling him to go do. He doesn't need this license to do that. His license is available here in town hall. He can apply for it just like anyone else. He's had his opportunity. He's had a great opportunity where he was. It's unfortunate. Maybe it's not unfortunate. I don't know what the business terms were of your sale. So sometimes maybe it wasn't unfortunate for you. So I'm not, you know, but that's, again, that's personal. And we don't know your terms and conditions of what happened, and nor should we. But the bottom line is we have a responsibility, and these liquor licenses are important, and we should make the right decision. And that is go through it, what the motion is drafted for, at least read it, and let's vote on that.
Okay. Well, at this point, I'm not exactly sure where we are, so... I'll entertain a motion. We'll see. We'll vote it up or down.
Close the hearing. Do you have any more input
before
we close the hearing?
I've said all. If it's granted, I don't like to open discussion for how long the renewal is. If I'm going to give a non-appeal clause, But once we get there, we get there. If I want to sign non-appeal, I'd like to make sure I have enough time to make a business work, or what the tenets of that would be, whether it be, do I have to get it approved in those 3 months, or do I need to have the application filed, or do I need to update the board in 3 months, or go, okay, I'm working with this company on this lease for this space, we're trying to hammer out the details, if we're going to do that, I just wouldn't want to know the details of it before I grant a non-appeal guarantee.
I think the expectation is whatever date we decide to renew it, until it would have to be transferred by then. It'd have to be a done
applied
deal.
Applied and
transferred.
No, it'd have to be.
I'm not sure
that we may. We don't have to go the full 6 months.
I'm at the ABC. I'm just worried about if I apply here in February, and the ABC takes 5 months to approve it, because they take forever sometimes with their department.
But the thing is, it's the action of this board. If the board agrees to transfer the license, you know, in February or whatever, early March, whatever it is, you know, then it's up to the ABCC. If they kick it back for some reason, you know, then we'd have to consider that. But at that point, you know, the board will have already taken action. The only time the ABCC is going to see this is unless and until we take action.
Right. I just want to make sure, clarify that, what the time frame meant.
Well, we'll discuss that after I close the hearing. Did you have another question, Catherine?
No, I just was curious to know what do you think is a realistic time frame given your circumstance? Because what do you think is a reasonable time frame?
I would ask for 3 to 4 months, only because I might get my funds mid-January. Might. The franchisors sometimes slow on their commitment. And I have travel planned for 9 days around my children's school vacation, so I'll be away at the end of February. So that period, that's, by case law, I started with 6 months. I don't intend to drag it out forever. So 3-4 months would be ideal. There'll be something done before that.
March 31.
Any other questions before I close the hearing?
I have a question of the applicant then. So if we were to renew this application till March 31st,
right,
would you agree to, you know, not appeal the decision of the board, take it to the ABCC? So in other words, you have to have it done before us and approved by March or the 30th.
Approved 30th. Or application in before then?
Application in and approved
and
by March 31st by
before
us.
Okay. Yeah,
before us. Again, I don't care what the ABCC
okay.
does. They can approve it.
So if I came, I'm not sure what the hearing is. So if I submit it March 22nd, but your next hearing isn't until April 1st, is that, am I outside my window?
I would say yes. Huh?
Yeah, of course.
March
well,
31st.
Obviously.
So I have just like this is the 31st.
But are we talking about appealing cancellation or appealing a new petition before the board? What are we talking about?
Appealing the decision that we make this evening, first of all. If we
cancellation.
The cancellation. In other words, we're extending this license until March 31st. And at that point in time, the license expires. And if we decide to have another hearing, such as a cancellation hearing, you would agree not to appeal that.
Okay.
Go ahead. Help me out.
Mike.
A couple of things. So first, the stipulation could really only be tied to the cancellation of the license. We wouldn't have a situation where we could require Mr. Pendleton to bind somebody seeking to get the license not to appeal if we deny the transfer. So it would only be of the decision to cancel if that were to be the case. The second thing, I know the board members aren't going to like this, but I think that the fairest thing that we can reliably do is set a date for application, that he needs to have a completed application to the Board of Selectmen, because we find, and Jane can attest to this, we end up in kind of a scramble every time these applications come in trying to figure out when the hearing is. If the board wants to figure out the date that it wants to make a decision and backtrack from that, then let's do that. But I wouldn't want to bind an agreement to the board's ability to have a hearing, because that could be complicated depending upon when it's submitted.
It could be in the middle of budgets. And
Mr. Chairman?
Yes,
the other thing is we meet on the first and third weeks of the month. So.
Correct.
I know we put a deadline on the 31st, and that wouldn't make any sense, because if our second meeting is on the 22nd.
I was just looking at our schedule. Our scheduled meeting is March 20th, is our last meeting in March.
So that's what it would really mean, March 20th and not the 31st.
I would simply ask then if we could move it to this meeting in April, because then it's the first meeting in April, because it's 2 weeks. You have to provide, it's been a long time since I put a new application, I put an application to myself. You have to provide public notice and put things in the newspaper, and I'm not exactly sure the process. I don't know how long times that I've done that and how long that actually takes. So we could get, you know, just give me, because I'll be again away at the end of February to get stuff in submitted, but if that's what it is, that's what it is. I mean, I'm just trying. That would be my only request, the first hearing in April. And that would mean the application has to be in by March 15th, probably get heard in time for the first.
April 3rd.
Is it, it sounds to, and I, again, we don't have anything substantively before us, but it sounds to me like it's something for you, for a new business, for you. Is that accurate?
Unless somebody has a proposal to come in and transfer the licenses to another business. I haven't got anything concrete on that front. I have a business plan that I'm working on that I was pursuing when this, I got the notice and I stopped because it wasn't, I couldn't go forward, make deposits, or do anything along that lines, or even negotiate further without any idea whether I was going to have the license to negotiate with or to place anywhere.
Bob, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Our first meeting in April is April 3rd.
It's the first Monday in April.
That's the first Monday in
yeah.
April. So.
So you make it till April 15th, if that's what you're inclined to do. Make it till April 15th, and he's got to be in by the 3rd. And again, as far as what the dates are, you know, it could just apply through March,
we
knowing that our regularly scheduled meeting is April 3rd.
We can't just put a date certain, April 3rd? Why keep adding numbers? Don't I just say April 3rd?
Because we may want to continue.
You just keep going further and further. Oh, you might as well do the 6 months, honestly. Put it in June. We've gone from January to March
I was going to the end of January, and someone was talking, you know.
That's 4 months.
All right. We're not okay. Converging now. We're diverging. Any other questions, Mr. Pelican?
Any input from other people who were here previously?
Christiana Pavadapoulou, my husband Stelios, is the owner of and the proprietor of the premises at 202 North Street. I just want to speak to, we value Mr. Pendleton's business, you know, Tedeschi and Captain Pizza together. We're a good combination and we respect the investment that he made, and I know that my husband would like to work with him. In terms of a bona fide applicant, the gentleman who applied and was denied by your body is not associated with us at the premises of 202 North Street. And I don't believe you can say that you denied 202 North Street, you denied a particular business. So I just want to get clarity on that. Also, I'm very happy to hear that you're speaking about small businesses. I know that that you wanted to go on the record on the 21st of November for your support of small businesses. Stelios has owned the business of Captain Pizza for 29 years. That's 29 years, 7 days a week that he's been there. And he, you know, finally had the opportunity and the funding to purchase the building. And so he has been faithful in providing tax revenue for this community. He has been faithful to the firefighters, to the North Reading Police Department, to the State Police Department, and to any organization that has come to us. He has supported them. And I understand that this is ad nauseum for you, that this has come up many times, and that I've stood here and I've tried to make you visualize what we're asking for. But this is blood, sweat, and tears, and from Mr. Pendleton and from Stelios. And so what we're asking you to do is give us time. We are a bona fide applicant. I understand completely that you didn't want a smoke shop. That is not what we are on our premises any longer. And I just, for the record, you also on the 21st of November spoke about the appropriateness of granting licenses and this idea of holding something until something was more appropriate. We gave you 300 residents of North Reading because we had 3 days. We'd give you 1,000 if we had 10 days. You know, where we serve the people of North Reading on a daily basis. And what they want to do is they want to pick up a large Captain Special and they want to go next door and they want to pick up a 12-pack of Bud. I understand it's nice boutique and new business and that kind of thing, but I think that you have to be loyal to the existing businesses that were there through the 80s when it was awful, through the 90s. That's what we're asking you to do. My father's a retired police lieutenant, and I asked him about what is the most important thing in terms of liquor licensing, and he said public safety and integrity. And one of you mentioned tonight the question of saying that they never had a problem. We've never had a problem at that premises. You have the record. We have a phenomenal relationship with our police department and integrity. You know that we will keep the children, the teenagers, and the inebriated people that should not be driving safe. We are integral in our neighborhood. And, Stelios deserves to grow his business, and Lucky Mart deserve to grow their business, because it is an amalgam. Just what, when you looked at the last petition and why about the parking, because selling liquor increases the volume. And that increases our business, and we deserve that. We deserve to get a second look at that. We are a bona fide applicant.
Okay. I appreciate your comments, but that's not what this public hearing is about.
Is he petitioning?
No. We're not. Right. We don't have an applicant before us for a license.
Right. I understand that, but I felt because there was verbiage of bona fide applicant contextually, we are involved in this license because Stelios is in dialogue with Mr. Pendleton because it's the 25th hour to not have Mr. Pendleton's investment go to naught. So it is, I understand, I get tangential because it's our blood, sweat, and tears, but it is related. Mr. Pendleton's license is related, and we will be a bona fide applicant, and I didn't want to let that go.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, you folks weren't here when we had the hearing the first time.
No, it was a different group.
No, it was for their location, but you guys weren't here.
They had a second.
You came with the second one, but you weren't here for the first one, right, Mr. Pendleton? They weren't here.
I could not be here either, to be honest. I was in travel.
I'm just saying.
When you guys set the hearing date.
All of that feedback you have is very valuable. It would have been valuable that evening when we had the hearing. But, this is one of the reasons why I want the license to end tonight, put it back on the shelf, and then allow businesses in the community like yourself to apply for it. That's the way it's supposed to work. This is, what we're trying to do here. I respect what you're trying to achieve here, okay? You had your opportunity, you did well, you brought two here, you brought a couple here. It didn't work for the board up to this point. There's businesses like Captain's Pizza that's been here a long time, could have an opportunity now to come in here and provide an option to apply for that license. That's what this is about. That's what I see in this community. That's what I'd like to see happen. You don't have a bona fide business right now. You're not an LLC of any form or anything that could qualify for this license. So I don't know what this board is, where you're trying to go with all this. I don't know, but there's a perfect example of what I'm trying to talk about right there. There's a lot of businesses that have made a lot of investment in this community that would love to have an opportunity to maybe change the portfolio of their business and make a request for this type of a liquor license to expand their services. But you guys can continue to go on down your direction to give an extension, but I'm going to vote against it.
Okay. At this point, I'm closing the hearing, and I'll ask the board. Anyone want to make a motion?
Can I just have a quick question for Mike? Does Captain Pizza, would they be applying for a restaurant license?
I'm not sure what they may be applying for. We could ask them to clarify. I did hear the terms "we" and "us." I'm just not sure who that is.
Too much.
It's for Lucky Mart. I don't know.
Would they have to, do we have restaurant license available?
Do we have a beer and wine license?
I don't believe that that's what they're looking for. I think they're looking for the beer and wine, not for service, but for sale. Just takeout.
For them, for their place?
Either for themselves or for Lucky Mart.
Which Lucky Mart was the one,
No, that was a different applicant.
That was a different one.
Different applicant, same location, different applicant.
Right.
I guess.
But if Captain Pizza wanted to apply, they could, right?
But this would not be a venue.
No, I know, of course.
This would not be the license. You know, we'd have to check the inventory again, but if they wanted to have a beer and wine license, they would need to come to town hall and apply for one.
Right.
For on-premise consumption, obviously, at that establishment.
But if they wanted to be able to sell it.
To the restaurant.
To takeout.
No, it's.
Not on premises, but.
I don't know if that's what they're applying or asking or insinuating or not, unfortunately.
I just wanted to, I was trying to clarify that.
All right, are we in any position to, we either deny the license or we agree to some form of an extension? I think those are the two.
I'll need some help in wording a motion to grant the extension of the license of the, is this a malt liquor license or a?
It's a beer and wine.
Beer and wine, okay.
Sale of beer and wine.
That we extend or approve the beer and wine license for a period of 3 months.
Motion, you said? Yeah, it'd be one.
Providing him an extension.
Convenience plus.
For 3 months, an extension for 3 months.
Months effective January 1st.
Effective January 1st.
You really have, that's got the outstanding motions, I think it's in there.
Are you putting that in form of a motion?
Yes.
Okay. Any stipulations?
Oh, no, I'm sorry, mistaken.
That if they, that they will not, appeal the decision.
Of the board.
Of the board at that time. So they, and I would assume that that would mean that they'd be, in that 3 months, if he can come to us at two different times, if he wants, but it all has to be done in that timeframe.
What day were you using?
Effective January 1. 3 months from January 1.
So, January, March 30.
To March 31st.
All right, Mr. Chairman, if I might help you out here. I move to renew and extend package store wine and malt beverage license of, was it Pendleton?
Pendleton Ventures.
Pendleton Ventures. An extension time period to expire on March 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements, and further that, how should we put it in, Michael?
On the condition.
And further that under the condition that the applicant would not appeal, a cancellation decision by this board at that time, beyond that time.
May I? So on the condition that the applicant signs a stipulation to not appeal any board decision to cancel.
License after that date.
Yeah.
The license after that date.
Do I hear a second?
So.
I'll second that.
Discussion.
So it's canceled March 31st.
It expires March 31st.
And that's it. We wouldn't be, we would just be expecting him to bring the, turn the license in on March 31st.
Right, and again, we may.
Unless it gets transferred.
And again, we may choose, under the advice of counsel, to have another hearing such as this, to cancel it, and that he would stipulate that he would not appeal that decision, if the board so chose to do so. How are you with that? March 31st, so that means you've got to get.
Application deadline, March 31st.
No. No. So you didn't get your April 15th deadline. You've got to get your application in early to mid-March, you know, in order. Our last meeting.
March 22nd.
Our last meeting, I believe, is March 20th.
So it has to be in about beginning March 6th to get it.
Right.
You need to allow a week before that, at least, so that we can publish, because we need to notify the newspaper 2 weeks in advance. So you really, to be safe, you're talking a month in advance. I mean, I hate to say it, maybe that last week of February.
But we'll work with.
Yeah, but we can figure the timeline out, but it's.
We think 3 months is more than reasonable at this time.
All right, so we have a motion and a second.
Michael has some input.
So, Mr. Chairman, when I've been involved in such a stipulation occurring, I would encourage the board not to prolong this, but I think we should have a written stipulation that the applicant signs right now on file if the board's going to vote favorably for it. It's the best protection rather than
How about subject to a written stipulation?
Okay.
In the motion. That way, then we can draw it up and you can come in and sign it.
Okay. I can sign when I pick up the application. When I pick up the license.
Or you can come in and sign it this week.
Can we release the license?
You can come in and sign it this week.
Yes. Preferably by the end of the day Thursday.
You're adding to the.
We had subject to a stipulation.
Yeah, to a stipulation being signed.
But the stipulation being signed.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table. Any other questions or comments? I'll ask for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Are those opposed?
Opposed?
No.
No.
Two opposed? Three in support.
3-2.
Motion carries.
Can you write that out?
Mr. Prisco, Mrs. May.
No. She wrote it.
Jane, you have that.
Yeah, she has that.
Yeah.
Okay. Jeff.
She looked up. Just pull the motions up so we can go through them in order.
Oh, I need a pen.
Do you want me to make the motions while you?
Okay. We have a motion, license renewal, common victualler.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following common victualler licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Andrea's House of Pizza, Beyond Bagels, Captain.
Do you mind closing that door?
Excuse me.
Captain Pizza, Dairy Queen, Great American Tavern, Group One Entertainment, Hillview, Heavenly Donuts, Joe Fish, McDonald's Restaurant, Mike's Famous Roast Beef and Pizza, Nan's Cafe, North Reading Christopher Club, S&M Subway of North Reading, Sports, Spirits and Steaks, Starbucks Coffee, The Hornet's Nest, The Lobster Claw, Teresa's Prime, Grill 19, Viasa LLC, DBA Subway.
Did I hear you say Puppuccino's?
No.
It's
you
on
did
the
not.
List.
It's struck from the list.
The Wendy's also?
Wendy's is struck from the list.
She has a revised motion.
She has a revised?
Yeah, there are two separate motions for those establishments based on regulatory issues.
All right. On a motion then,
second.
Do we hear a second? Second by Mr. O'Leary. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We'll call it unanimous. We have common victualler, all alcohol.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following common victualler all alcohol licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Great American Tavern, Group One Entertainment, Hillview, Joe Fish, Sports, Spirits, and Steaks, Teresa's Prime, Grill 19.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? We have package store all alcohol.
This
is Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following package store all alcohol licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Eastgate Liquors.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous?
Yeah.
We have package store wine and malt beverage. Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following package store wine and malt beverage license to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Convenience Plus and Speedway.
Second.
Second by Mr.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Gilberto's comment.
Mr. Chairman, as was included in the supplemental today from the Board of Health, there is an ongoing matter involving the Board of Health regarding Convenience Plus and their ability to sell certain date-sensitive foods. Right now, my understanding is that they are not selling certain date-sensitive foods. This is a matter that's being handled by the Board of Health that may require a hearing by the Board of Health in January if the establishment's not able to come into compliance. I just note that more for the record than anything else.
Any other comments?
Well, do we want to do a separate motion on this one and make it a change the expiration until after the hearing, or give it, make it for maybe the end of March?
The board has the discretion to do that, to renew it for a defined period and pending the outcome. I don't know that it needs to be that long, to be honest with you. My understanding from talking to the health director, this has been a situation that's been ongoing for roughly a month, and I expect that the Board of Health will have a hearing in roughly 1 month from now. So I don't think it even needs to go, you know, far into February.
This is for
Convenience Plus.
Yeah, but this is for a wine and malt beverage license. This isn't
right,
for the common vigil is a.
That's correct. This would be for a wine and malt beverage license.
So this isn't necessarily.
What are the wishes of the committee
related to
well, the well, they have to have a victualler's license to have a liquor license, so.
But if he doesn't get his common vicular license.
Based on what we've.
You may not want him to have this. Right?
Say, no, we don't.
You're right.
Well, I would think if the situation warrants it, the Board of Health's going to shut him down anyway.
Right.
So should we.
They do their job.
Yeah.
Hold it in advance pending the Board of Health determination.
I think that was more of an FYI.
Just to be clear, they do not have a common victual license. They don't serve food for consumption on premises. It's
so
only for
off. So what's the Board of Health issue? With the wine
date,
and beer?
No, date-sensitive foods such as milk or other products not being rotated properly on the shelves. So it's a Board of Health matter, obviously. I just want to make sure the Board's aware of it.
Ketchup.
Before it takes any action.
Good. Yeah, good.
Okay.
So I think we had a motion and a second by Mr. Yule. Do we want to continue with this, or do we want to modify?
I'm all set. Just let the Board of Health do their job.
I mean, I don't. The Board of Health has its job to do.
No.
This is.
Okay. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We have the Fraternal Club. Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following Fraternal Club licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Second.
Loyola Order of Moose and North Reading Christopher Club.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We have a Class 2 license. Mr. O'Leary.
Mr. Chairman, I will not be deliberating and the discussions in relation to the motion that's about to be made on a Class 2 license, as I have a family member who also holds a Class 2 license, so I will not be deliberating or voting on the matter.
Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following Class 2 license to expire January 1st, 2018. Subject to all regulatory department requirements, JMM Enterprises, Inc., DBA A1 Auto Sales, 144 Main Street, North Reading.
Do we hear a second?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Sorry, Michael.
I am going to abstain from this vote just because my brother-in-law is good friends with the owner and sometimes does some side work for him on occasion, so I'm going to abstain from voting on this one.
Okay. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Abstentions?
Aye.
Me.
Two.
Motion passes three?
Two abstentions.
Three, 0, 2.
Both reasons were stated.
Okay. I didn't
Okay, we have automatic amusement devices. Mrs. Menapelli?
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following automatic amusement device licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Cowabunga's Entertainment LLC, Loyal Order of Moose, Sports, Spirits, and Steaks.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? That's unanimous. Next motion is a jukebox motion. Mrs. Menapelli?
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following jukebox license to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements, Loyal Order of Moose.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We have livery.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following livery license to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory requirements. Metro Town Car.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule.
Where are they located?
220, it's Nathan Serafian, DBA Metro Town Car, 23 Chestnut Street.
Okay.
It comes to mind that I take a livery to the airport that operates.
Did you second that?
Yes, I did.
Behind.
I think I'll have to have a livery on Chestnut Street. Used to be.
Boston North.
The ones that used to be, you were Larkins used to be, you mean? Larkins?
Yeah, Larkins. Behind that building somewhere.
They used to be. I don't know if they're still there.
They used to.
I know. I don't know if they're still
open.
Yeah,
I was wondering.
Oh, you mean they may not be?
Right.
They may not be. They may, okay.
Yeah, they used to
be. They moved out of town.
Right.
Okay.
He's got a bunch there, so he might want to.
On the motion, I heard a second on the livery, Mr.
Yes,
Yule.
I seconded it.
Okay. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. We have Sunday entertainment.
These are done. Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following Sunday entertainment licenses to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements. Great American Tavern, Group One Entertainment LLC, Hillview, Sports, Spirits, and Steaks, Teresa's Prime Rib.
Second.
Grill 19.
Second by Mr. Yule.
Oh, Steve doesn't.
On the motion, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
One
opposed?
Of them does.
Steve.
No.
The next group are appointments.
No. Mr. Chairman. Yeah. Mr. Chairman. We have two separate motions that we generated regarding establishments for which
okay, I don't have visibility of it, Mrs. Menapelli.
So I'll just provide an update if that's okay.
Okay.
Mrs. Menapelli.
Yes.
First is regarding Wendy's. We've received a renewal application from this establishment. We have not received a copy of their workers' compensation insurance. It's not a situation where we don't believe that they have it, but we simply don't have it on file. And so we've got a separate motion in there that stipulates that the renewal will be subject to their providing that workers' compensation insurance. So if the board wants to take that motion up, I'll refrain from providing a further update.
I don't think Steve signs that. I don't think Steve signs that.
You want that?
I think Steve signs it. Oh, shit.
It should be on condition that they provide it?
Yes, it's stated in the motion that's in the supplement. Should be written down the bottom of it.
Okay.
Do you have it?
Yes.
Mrs. Manapelli?
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following common victualer license to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements, including the condition that Wendy's produce evidence of workers' compensation insurance by Wendy's, on Wendy's.
May I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? You got one more?
We have two others.
Two others, okay.
First is Papagino's, which despite numerous communications via email and telephone, has failed to submit a renewal application. We believe it's their intention to renew their application based on those conversations. So we have a renewal in there that would require a status review on January 3rd, 2017. Absent board action, if they were to present an application for renewal, obviously it would not be able to be considered until at least January 3rd.
So what are you recommending?
So there's a motion in there, and I'd like to take, it's written to include Greenbrier Classic Motors, but through you to Ms. Manapelli, I think we should handle that one separately because the story is a little more complicated.
So, Mr. Chairman.
So, I mean, this goes back to discussion that we've had in the past regarding people that don't renew their license and we have to chase them around, and this is a case of that. So, what communication have you sent them?
They've received numerous letters.
Numerous letters.
Going back to the board's suggestion, I think, earlier this year.
Have they been warned that if they don't renew the license?
Several times, Mr. Chairman.
This one
will not be able to operate come January 1st?
Several times, Mr. Chairman.
And Papagino's comment.
This board knows how I feel about it. I've brought it up for like the last 5 years, and you know, I thought we had made the message pretty clear last year. You know, I wish there was a way to recover the expense on the town. All the time and labor your staff has to go through, the extra efforts they have to go through. When all these other licensees submit on time, they submit it correctly, and these, you always have these outliers that just feel the process isn't for them. That's why I'm voting against granting the license. And I think that's what it's going to have to take. Unfortunately, someone's going to lose out on a license. This board's going to end up voting with me unanimously to vote against granting this license. And they'll have to bear with the consequences.
Are you proposing a approval of conditional license? Is that what you were proposing, Michael?
The motion as written would do that because I don't have any other way to facilitate a license when it gets delivered to our office sometime after tonight's meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But the board has been very clear in its prior discussions with regard to this, and I think we sent a letter out far in advance of the renewal season to advise folks that this was going to be the case. Not to belabor the point, but this is an establishment that does business in probably hundreds of communities in Massachusetts, so it's surprising that this would be the situation.
Mr. Chairman? Mr. Gimblera, can we establish a rate fee for this? I know it's not in our, I assume, bylaws to do that now.
You're saying for a late renewal fee? It's something we could discuss with town council. I would imagine that there is some way to get at that issue from a cost standpoint.
We have to recover our expenses on this. These are unnecessary expenses that are unbudgeted for. Your staff has a lot to do. This is one of the busiest times of the year. As we start to prepare for the budgets, the time that they would be investing their hours would be on those types of things. Instead, they're being diverted to go back and forth to do the same work over and over again. So we have to find a way to recover those expenses, and I think the board has to take a stance. If we're not going to deny licenses, which probably seems a little unreasonable, the most reasonable thing is to make them bear the expense. I think that's the right and appropriate thing to do.
Mr. Chairman?
Is this a repeat? This a repeat the same outfit as last year?
No?
Jeffrey?
Yeah. Are we allowed to have
a
past due charge on these? Are we allowed to do that?
No, we'd have to
I think that's what
That's what I'm requesting that we...
So that's what Mike is requesting, right?
I'm just asking.
As a policy, can't we have a policy?
We have to come up with something that's going to get the attention. And, you know, in some cases, if they're first-time offenders, I get it. It happens occasionally. But there are some people I know, they were better this year than they have been in the past years. But if it continues to be a problem, we should have a way to recover the expense associated with us going through the extra effort on some. The town shouldn't have to bear that price.
Bob?
Yes.
This way.
Are they repeat? I know you haven't addressed Greenbrier, but is Papagino's one of those repeat offenders?
No, not to my knowledge.
No. It's the first time.
I mean, the way to get the attention is to deny it if they don't have their application, and it's pretty basic. You didn't apply, so you're not going to get the license.
So I guess Michael suggesting in the proposal that we approve it tentative on the,
an administrative cost for the extra attempts to get them to file?
I don't think we can do that. I think we have to go follow some kind of...
We've written a motion to conduct the business, the administrative end of the business in the offices. The board determines it wishes to not renew an application that it does not have before it right now, and that's within the board's discretion.
Yeah.
So that's the only alternative that we have? We don't have...
That's right.
We can't assess a late fee or anything like that?
We may be able to. I'm just not, I'm not confident I can sit here and tell you the vehicle to do that right now in this process. So I don't want to make a commitment that I can't necessarily follow up on legally. There may be a way to get at the issue. I'm just not sure what it is.
But this is for an automatic amusement device. Did they have their other application in?
It's common victual.
This says
it's common victualer as well.
This just says automatic amusement device. It doesn't say common victuals. It says video games. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. So if it's not in, we shouldn't be moving to renew it. We don't have an application to renew. Why are we moving to renew it?
Because we're business friendly.
I leave that to the board's discretion.
Oh, I forgot that.
We know they're not going anywhere. So.
Well, they're not the, they're not a, it's the, I don't know if it's their first offense, but there was an initial last year with them. At least that's what I'm hearing, right?
That's my understanding.
So I would recommend to the board that we approve the license pending them actually filing and paying the license fee. And if we want to try to create a fine for late filing, then we should discuss that and create it appropriately.
I think that's a good agenda item going forward. Create a policy that, first, second, or third time, you can have a tiered level of penalties. I agree with Mike that we should be recouping the added cost that we have every year by companies not submitting their license request. So, put that on January.
Someone want to propose a motion to...
Do you have a motion?
There was a motion.
There's a motion.
You go with the motion. That's what's written. It's fine.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following license to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements and a status review on January 3rd, 2017, subject to this licensee providing proper application and fee.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't read it. It's Papagino's. Sorry. Common victualler automatic amusement device.
That,
sorry.
Right.
Yeah.
On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Unanimous.
Mr. Chairman, through you, the final licensing action relates to Greenbrier Classic Motors, a Class 2 license. The board may recall that the proprietor passed away at the towards the end of calendar year 2015, if I remember correctly,
yep.
And the board opted to extend a grace period into the month of February of that year, whereby the daughter of the owner appeared before the board and opted to renew the license. We have not received a renewal application from this petitioner for 2016, which would be a license that would go into effect on January 1st of 2017, January 1st, 2017. We have a license in, we have a similar motion in here that would afford them the opportunity to renew the license through January 3rd of 2017 for a status review, but it's certainly the board's discretion to decide whether it wants to grant that.
Again, notices have been sent to the appropriate people.
A number of notices have been sent, and we don't have...
And they are operating?
No, we don't have any information regarding the establishment, but we know the police department visited the site, and there's no evidence of a business operational there at this point.
There's no operation?
None that is evident to us, and there's been no application received. However, knowing that the business is going into transition, we don't know that we have the whole story or not, but we know we do not have an application.
Well, I see no problem with doing what we just did, because if they don't apply, then the license isn't an issue.
It's the board's discretion.
Yeah.
I know the family's in transition.
We have a motion, similar motion.
And again, Mr. Chairman, I will be not deliberating or taking any action. I'm standing here as a Class 2 license because I have a family member who holds
what
a Class 2
you,
license.
I can vote on this one.
You can?
Okay. Yep.
All right, Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the following licenses to expire December 31st, 2017. Subject to all regulatory department requirements and a status review on January 3rd, 2017, subject to licensee providing proper application and license fee. Greenbrier Classic Motors, Class 2.
Mr. Chairman, through you, we just would, we didn't create the right date. It should say January 1st, 2018, just because of the way the law is written.
January, okay.
It's a one-year license. It just happens to run January 2nd to January 1st, as I understand it.
Okay. You added that to the motion?
Yes. January 1st?
Yes.
2018.
On the motion, do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention?
Aye.
Mr. O'Leary. And does that take it for licenses?
I believe so, Mr. Chairman.
We will move into appointments. The first one is for the Board of Appeals. Mr.
Chairman.
O'Leary, I guess.
Yep.
Get your input before we make a motion.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman. Mr. John Nelson has been a longtime member and associate member of the Board of Appeals. He's put in for reappointment as an associate member of the Board of Appeals, for which we're grateful for his service, and I would recommend a reappointment.
A motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following name for reappointment as an associate member of the Board of Appeals for a term to expire on December 31st, 2019. One opening, John D. Nelson, 103 Lowell Road. He's incumbent.
I hear a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. I think we'll read the motion first, and then we'll get a report from the appropriate person or persons.
Oh, no. Can you pass this?
Taxation Aid Committee.
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following names for reappointment as members of the Taxation Aid Committee for a term to expire on December 31st, 2019. Two openings, Marianne McKay, incumbent, Debbie Carboni, incumbent.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. I take it, Mr. Gilberto, that you're in support of the committee.
Yes, my understanding is that they've served in this capacity
right.
for quite a long period of time, and I believe that they may both be statutory.
Yes,
state
I
law.
Think you're right.
Yes,
but Mr. Yule is a liaison. I think you're a liaison.
Yes.
I may know
yes,
better.
Yes, I am, and yes, they are yes. statutory.
Okay, so on the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We have Water Commission.
Mrs.
Manapelli.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman. I move to place in nomination the following name for appointment as a member of the Water Commission for a term to expire on December 31st, 2019. One opening, Amit Subramani, 29 Little Meadow Way, new.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Who's liaison?
Me.
Who said me?
I am.
Mike. As in Prisco.
Any recommendation or you're making?
Yes, this. Gruden has a very good resume, and we're just very happy he submitted because we were down. We need members. We actually need, I think we need more than one member. I'm surprised it's only one opening.
Yeah. Maybe for this term.
Okay.
I believe we just, this will, I think, get us a quorum, if
okay.
I'm not mistaken, right?
Yes.
Because we had a quorum, we lost one.
Right, we lost one, right.
And I think there are at least, there may be two other openings.
Two others, yeah.
Okay, so on the motion for the Water Commission, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. The next one is Library Trustees.
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following names for reappointment or appointment as members of the Library Trustees for a term to expire on October 31st, 2019. There are two openings. One, Catherine Scannell, 44 Burroughs Road, an incumbent. Sarah Harrington, associate member, 6 Hemlock Road, incumbent. Three, Thomas Kelly, associate member, 4 Burnham Drive, incumbent.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Okay. I'm liaison to the Library Trustees. There's two openings, there are two associate members, and Sarah Harrington is the one I'm recommending, and Thomas Kelly has stated that he's fine with that, and he's going to stay on as an incumbent.
Incumbent. An associate member associate. Or as a full member?
As an associate member, I'm sorry.
So we still have an opening?
So
no, we have two openings. We one Sarah Harrington.
Well, it's confusing.
Catherine Scannelli is the incumbent.
Scannell.
Full member.
Full
trustee.
Right.
So you're recommending Catherine Scannell and Sarah Harrington.
And Sarah Harrington, right. Sarah Harrington is currently an associate, and she's stepping up.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't mean to confuse
you. So we shouldn't say associate member then, right?
Well, she's currently an associate.
All right. So I will call for a roll call vote. Mr. O'Leary.
Catherine Jeffrey and Scannell and Sarah Harrington.
Mr. Yule.
Catherine Jeffrey and Scannell and Sarah Harrington.
Mrs. Menapelli.
Catherine Scannell and Sarah Harrington.
Mr. Prisco.
Mrs. Scanlon, Mrs. Harrington.
And the chair votes Catherine Jeffrey and Scannelli and Sarah Harrington.
I don't think it's Scannelli.
I don't think
Scannell,
it's
Scannell, by the way.
Scannell.
And I want to thank Lorraine Sheehan.
Oh, yes, for
Mr. Chairman.
Service.
In 30 years.
Right, we had a they had a reception.
Yeah, the paper, sorry I missed
yeah,
it.
Yeah, that was, she's been on town committees and on the library for all that time. And they had a very nice reception. Gilberto attended. Yes, he was there. Martin's Pond Study Committee. Thank you, Steve, for reminding me that. Mrs. Manapelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following names for reappointment as members of the Martin's Pond Study Committee for a term to expire December 31st, 2019. There are three openings. Janet Nicosia, 2 Poplar Terrace, incumbent. Lori Linz, 14 Camille Road, incumbent. Catherine Jeffrian Scannell, 44 Burroughs Road, incumbent.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? There's three openings and
three people.
Three incumbents. Three incumbents. Yep. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Process serving constables. We have 5 openings and we have 7 candidates. And Mrs. Manapelli, could you read the motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following names for reappointment or appointment as process-serving constables for a term to expire on December 31st, 2017, five openings. One, Paula DeRosiers, 5 Aldersgate Way, incumbent. Two, David Rosati, 8 Chester Street, incumbent. Three, John Ferrilio, 1 Sullivan Road, incumbent. Four, Paul Dorsey, 10 Northridge Drive, incumbent. Five, Douglas Lab, 130 Chestnut Street, incumbent. Six, Neil Rooney, 13 Pomeroy Road, on file. Seven, Ronald E. Bertheim Methuen, on file.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Yule.
I'm going to be recommending 4 incumbents and 1 who has a name on file. They would be Policy de Rosier, David Rossetti, John Fiorello, Paul Dorsey, and number 6, Neil Rooney. Now, I just want to reemphasize what I've said now for, this will be the 3rd year. I think it's important that when we honor veterans, that we truly honor veterans, not with flags, not with plaques, but with jobs. And Neil Rooney, a Vietnam, a highly decorated Vietnam vet who has served his country and served his community like we do. All right. He has spent quite a number of years on the community, the CPC, and has been involved in the community in other areas. And I think that we need to show veterans that we mean what we say, and we say thank you for your service, and what can we do for you? Mr. Rooney is a well-respected individual, a very sincere individual, a dedicated individual, and I would urge, or request, I beg, that we allow Mr. Rooney to become a constable for the town of North Reading. So.
Any further discussion?
I just have a Jeff, are you aware as to whether or not these individuals are actively participating in the process of process-serving constables or not? I know last year Mrs. DeRosa had come in and she was going to be working with her husband and going to be active in that. Mr. Fiorello, we know he stands here and witnesses our signature all the time. Mr. Paul Dorsey is a retired police sergeant down in North Reading. Doug Lab, we know, from Chestnut Street, and of course we know Neil. I don't know the gentleman from Methuen, but I don't know Mr. Rossetti, I guess. I can't place a face with the name.
Right.
Do you know if they work for?
I haven't seen a lot of activity that they're involved in. I don't know if there's really a whole lot that they have been involved with in the town. Okay.
Well, no, but it might not just be for the town. They have to be appointed by the town they live in. I don't know why.
I'm sorry?
I said they have to be appointed by the town that they live in or work in, I guess. But they could be operating anywhere in the Commonwealth.
That's correct. That's correct. And they can be in a few other towns, okay? And I can't say that I know how active they really have been.
Okay. Very good.
Any other comments? Ask for a roll call vote.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I just a note that certainly the liaison's discretion to make a recommendation. I would just note, as the board members are aware, that we've scrutinized each of these applicants in the past for yes. appointment. And I would just leave it at that.
Mr. O'Leary.
Had their issues. Paula DeRosiers, John Fiorello, Paul Dorsey, Doug Lab, Neil Rooney.
Mr. Prisco.
Mrs. DeRoches, DeRoche, sorry. Mr. Rosati, Mr. Fariello, Mr. Dorsey, Mr. Lab.
Mrs. Manapelli.
Mrs. DeRozier, Mr. Rosati, Mr. Fiorello, Mr. Dorsey, and Mr. Lab.
Mr. Yule.
Yes, the Paula de Rosier, David Rosati, John Fiorello, Paul Dorsey, and Neil Rooney.
And the chair votes Paula DeRosier, David Rosati, John Fiorello, Paul Dorsey, and Douglas Lab.
Shoot.
And secretary report results.
So it will be, all the incumbents will be reappointed. Ms. DeRosier, Mr. Rosati, Mr. Fiorello, Mr. Dorsey, and Mr. Lab.
Next position is detail constable, Mrs. Menabelli.
Mr. Chairman, I move to place in nomination the following name for reappointment as a detail constable for a term to expire on December 31st, 2017. Jerry Berg, incumbent.
Second.
Second by Mr. Yule. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Is that it? No. There's some other motions that are not in our main packet.
What about that memorandum?
Yeah, they're in a separate.
Did we approve that memorandum? Could we do that?
We're not.
No.
We're not going.
We're going to pass over that.
Sorry.
Get with the kid.
Is it?
Yes, so you've concluded the actions that we have available for both the appointments and the licenses. I believe that there are a couple of committees for which action might still be required, so there may be a few more that come up in January.
Okay, that's what it's okay, vote to ratify the Mark Redding Administrator Staff Contract.
That's on hold.
That's on hold.
It's on.
Town Administrator's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Bear with me just one moment. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I provided an update in the town administrator's report relative to the town's community compact grant-funded projects, first of which, and I'll just read from it, we had a transportation grant aimed at trying to improve transportation services here in North Reading, where we do not have paratransit and other public transportation available. The town will be working with MAPC, our regional planning agency, on this study to look at transportation options for seniors and people with disabilities. As the town knows, we appropriated funding in the amount of $15,000 to supplement the grant compact award of $5,000, which gives us a total of $20,000. In the meantime, MAPC is working with the town and surrounding towns in the North Suburban subregion on a suburban mobility study. Our individual work for the town of North Reading will follow this larger study, expected to be completed within the next few months. While MAPC has begun preliminary work and scoping on North Reading's transportation study, most of the work will be done following completion of the subregion study, and we anticipate completion of our community compact project under this grant in the early spring. Similarly, regarding the sewer grant, we've certainly seen a bit of a delay due to some transition in the Public Works Department, but we do have a grant that's extended through to June 30th, 2017, and we have engaged Wright Pierce to develop a project scope and give us a proposal based on the grant award. We'll continue to keep the board updated. I'm pleased to report that Health Director Bob Bracey has been nominated to serve as chairman of the State Board of Health Officers, which is a state regulatory board. My understanding is that his appointment awaits confirmation by the governor's office. Mr. Bracey's been active as a vice chair over the past year in this group, just a reflection of his standing in the public health community. Selectmen Masseri and O'Leary and I met with the MWRA and the town of Reading for a status update on Thursday morning. We plan to attend a legislative joint committee on the environment, natural resources, and agricultural hearing scheduled for tomorrow, at which the town's special act for admittance to the MWRA will be considered. Relatedly, the acquisition process for 9 Mill Street for the pump station continues. We were required to post a 30-day unique acquisition notice in the Central Register, which required an extension of the closing under the purchase and sale until late January, and we're scheduling a closing to take place in late January, and have been working with the seller's attorney on that matter. I included a copy of the agenda for the meeting we had with MWRA in Reading, which was I think a good status update. We've been working with Representative Jones regarding this hearing tomorrow morning to make sure we put our best foot forward and provide documentation as was requested by the representative in advance of the hearing. So we gave him a packet today that the committee will see, and that we hope that the committee will be inclined to act favorably tomorrow morning on the hearing. I'd also would note that I received word from Representative Jones on Friday that the Joint Committee on Public Service reported out favorably our petition for home rule petition for civil service being rescinded in our police department, and the House of Representatives voted to move the legislation to a third reading at today's informal session. So both of those bills are moving along. We certainly are at the end of the legislative session, but hopefully we'll be able to move them forward before the conclusion, and if not, then we'll work early in the next legislative session. Representative Jones and Senator Tarbin are to work on our behalf. I think that concludes my comments. Thank you.
I just want to just make a comment regarding our meeting with the town of Reading and the MWRA, and we had a Reading's DPW department was represented along with ours, and just to get a sense of the level of cooperation, there's this 25-inch main that needs to be tested. It's unused currently in Reading. When they switched MWRA, there was a feed, I guess, from somebody else. And so it's been dormant. It's going to be part of the pipeline getting water back to North Reading. And there's been some questions about how to go test this thing. And initially, way it was proposed to be done was going to be fairly expensive, and then they were working with Wright Pierce, working on ideas to come up with another way that would cost money. And we're sitting here talking, and one of the DPW, I don't know if it was the director.
No, it wasn't the director. It was one of the superintendents. One of the foremen
turns around and he says, we can get you a even though we pulled a hydrant, we know where it is and there's an access there. So it was that kind of, working. And I just think back negotiating a water contract with the town of Andover, how long it took. And here, we're sitting with them, and they're already thinking about ways of making this thing work and making it, getting it done on time, and also saving some money in the process. I was pretty impressed.
That's good. That's good.
Steve, you want to start?
It was heartened to read in the Globe this week. We had a number of Globe All-Scholastic athletes from the fall sports, as well as All-Stars, and it's great to have North Reading represented and have so many young athletes doing so well. So congratulations to them. Other than that, I just want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah and Happy Holidays, and hopefully safe and joyous travels.
I'd like to just take a few minutes, Mr. Masseri, if I could, just to give the board an update on the status of the economic development's progress with the bids on the 104 Lowell Road. And the board recalls the old J.T. Berry property has two locations, 102 Lowell Road and 104 Lowell Road, which we know 104 Lowell Road is the only one we put out for bid. We had 5 bids received from 4 individual bidders. I'd like to just kind of run through, just in quick summary, what the 5 bids were, and then I'd like to just make an announcement on what the EDC's recommendation is to the Board of Selectmen, and then I'll give a little more information on that, and if there's any questions, I'll answer them then. So the first bid we received was from the Symes company, Symes. The proposal was a $5 million offer for the property, and they'd like to build 140 market rate housing units there. That was the first one. We received another proposal from another company called Garden Homes, and the offer was for $14.4 million. And they want to build 480 market rate housing units. We got another proposal from a company called Four Kicks, and they made an offer of $2.5 million for an indoor and outdoor sports complex. We had another bid from a company called Pulte Homes, and they provided actually two proposals. The first one was an $18.2 million offer to build 450 smart growth overlay 40R residential units, 20% affordable. And then they made another proposal from Pulte Homes, again, a $30 million offer, cash offer for the property, to build 450 age-restricted units for 55 years of age or older. So the EDC, we had a formal evaluation process set way in advance of receiving the proposals. We ran everything through council, so we had a lot of guidance. We conducted our evaluations the other evening. Mr. Yule was present at the meeting as well. And the EDC, we didn't have a unanimous selection, but out of the seven votes, we had six votes in favor of the Pulte Homes Scenario 1, which was $30 million cash offer for the 450 age-restricted units for 55 and older. And we had one vote in favor of the $2.5 million offer from Four Kicks. So rather than get into a lot of the nitty-gritty, we are prepared to present this at our January 3rd meeting. In between now and then, we are working on a final report. We will put that in writing, and I'm hoping to get that to you all here in the next week or so, so you can have it to evaluate it over the weekend, over the holiday break. In the meantime, the proposals are up into our Dropbox, so you can take a look at those in detail. But the EDC will submit a formal report to you to have in advance, and then we'll make a quick presentation. Francis DeCoste from TRA will be here to do a short presentation for you, and then Joe Lara, our chairman, will just make a quick announcement again on the recommendation we're making to the joint CPC and the Board of Selectmen. I'm just really encouraged, and I'm really happy with the variety that we got. I am a little overwhelmed. $30 million cash offer was that was pretty significant. I didn't expect that, but I did vote in favor of that from the EDC as my vote. But again, we'll make our formal recommendation on the 3rd, and then we'll leave it up to the board and the CPC to jointly make a decision. But I will take any questions if anyone has any.
Jeffrey?
Yeah, I just want to add, I don't have any questions, Mike. I just want to add to the observation with the EDC. They were very thorough, very careful. They interacted effectively to, question ideas and so on. So it was just a well thought out process. And I'm sure we're going to have questions on January 3rd, but when they looked at the numbers and they looked at the, what's the impact it's going to have down the road, they covered those bases. So I think they should be well prepared. I hope that we'll have all of the EDC members at the meeting on the 3rd, as well as obviously the CPC.
It's going to be a joint meeting with the CPC, Michael.
Yes, it is a joint meeting, yep.
Yes.
And has that been coordinated, Michael?
Yes, through the town planner and the members of the CPC that are on the EDC, yes.
Mm-hmm. But I believe what we have agreed to do is to allow the Board of Selectmen and the CPC to jointly have a discussion and to allow the feedback from their board as well as our board on what, you take our recommendation, you can do what you want with it. We'll present that in a formal report. Ultimately, if you decide this board and the CPC elect to go in a different direction, that's your prerogative. But I believe, if I have this correctly, the Board of Selectmen does ultimately make the final decision. But I think we should definitely respect the CPC's opinion into our decision. So.
I find that the, what I found most outstanding about the whole thing was that the range in value of the property, depending on what goes in there, from,
yeah.
You know, 30 million is almost $1 million an acre.
Yep.
2.4 million is what? A couple $100,000 an acre or something like that, if it's that much.
Yeah, no. But I can see why they can bid that. I mean, yeah. I have a pretty good understanding of what they're going to do there. And yeah,
it will require a special town meeting in March or beginning of April.
As soon as this board, this board feels comfortable that all the questions were answered and that they can make a decision that they're confident in, then I think we can go ahead and set that meeting. But I wouldn't do it until this board feels confident, because we're going to have to go in front of the town and make a presentation and make sure we're, even if it's not unanimous, at least we have our ducks in line and we can explain to them whatever this majority decision is going to be.
Are we on pace for the 65%?
We are.
Revenue
on sale? We are. We are good. We are good. Yep.
Anything else, Mike?
Just Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays to everyone. And, let's try to have some downtime, because we've all earned it. And I hope everyone enjoys your family time.
Catherine?
Same. Just hoping everyone has a peaceful, happy, calm, relaxing holidays and enjoys their Christmas and enjoys their holidays and Happy New Year.
Jeffrey?
It's up to me now, right? Well, I wish all my board members a Merry Christmas and a very prosperous and healthy 2016. I wish the same for our public and our employees in the town, again, that they have a happy, healthy, and prosperous 2016. So, thank you.
Thank you, Joe. I want to thank the board past calendar year on all your efforts and all the work that's been done for the benefit of the town. It seems like we're making a lot of progress in a lot of areas, and it wouldn't have happened if we were working together. I wish everybody a Merry Christmas, and that goes for everybody in town. I wish that everybody stays safe and we get to spend some time with our families before we get into the first of the year and get into our budget process and deal with the challenges that we know are coming associated with the budget, and also some of our opportunities that we're going to have to pay some attention to. And as Michael mentioned, Steve and I and Michael are going into Boston to advocate for getting the legislature to pass our home rule petition to join the MWRA. And,
thank you.
I think that's all I have to say. So I will ask for a motion to adjourn.
Adjourn. So moved.
So moved.
Second
by Mr. O'Leary. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carries.
Where are they from?
Thank you.